Mr. Speaker, and anyone that's listening, okay, so the House is in a fairly cantankerous spot right now. But part of my frustration and part of the reason for actually grabbing this hour is, what's a nice way to, what's a more elegant way to use the word, I need to stop the lying? Actually, I don't think we're supposed to say that on the floor. The people just making crap up. So let's actually have a sort of an educational discussion here. If you don't like math, please just turn off your television, stop watching, because this is becoming a math-free zone around here. And why is there the fighting here on the House? What's the fussing? You do understand every dime a member of Congress votes on now is all borrowed money. There's a very good chance, and we'll know actually next week when the final Treasury data is posted, that for this fiscal year, the 2023 fiscal year, which ends this weekend, we will borrow, and I'm sorry, but this is how you need to think about it, we will borrow functioning 9% of GDP. So 9% of the entire economy will be just the borrowed money, not the spent money, the borrowed money. We are hitting numbers that should be terrifying. I don't know why they're not terrifying to the folks on the left. Basically, you just saw it. They just came to the microphone saying, we want more money. Where does it come from? So let's actually walk through just some basic facts. And this isn't Republican or Democrat math. It's just math. And as the family saying is, math will always win. It may take a while, but the math will always win. So the reason for this chart, Mr. Speaker, is one more time to try to visualize. This is the 2023 budget. Okay, in that 2023 budget, here's what we call discretionary spending. This is defense and non-defense. Okay, we have 1.7 on this chart. It's actually closer to $1.8 trillion. This wedge over here is actually, let's just call it Medicare. Social Security still has its own trust fund, which is out in 9 years. So when you hear a Democrat saying, well, we don't borrow any of Social Security, you shouldn't be talking about it. The trust fund's gone in 9 years, and the recapitalization of it is brutal. But once again, our brothers and sisters on the left don't want to actually deal with the math because it's such a great campaign hit on anyone that actually cares about not doubling senior poverty in 9 years. So back to this chart. So when you look at this, you got to understand, this blue wedge is all we get to vote on. All the red, the 72% of spending we call mandatory, is on autopilot. You get that benefit because you worked your 40 quarters, you earned your Social Security benefit. You worked, you know, a certain amount, you paid into your Medicare, you turned 65, you get that benefit. You hit a certain age. That is the vast, vast majority of the spending, and it's also, if you go from today through the next 30 years, is 100% of the future debt. It's demographics. I say this over and over and over and over, and the idiot class around here who wants to say, no, it's Republicans not willing to tax people more. Stop it, because I'm going to walk you through all the Democrat tax proposals and show you how little of GDP it creates, even at tax maximization. There's this concept of, at this rate, you maximize tax receipts without rolling over and the economy and rolling over the fall of receiving less tax receipts. So I'm going to show you the math on maximizing. It's nowhere near what the Democrats keep telling you, and it's really crappy economics. So one more time, this board is incredibly important. You want to know why there's fussing around here. It's all borrowed now. And what's happened in the last couple months interest rate-wise? Think of this as just a thought experiment. August 1st till today, the movement in interest rates, just that movement in interest rates, is about $50 billion of interest next year. We're borrowing over $6 billion a day. That is functionally, let's take a look here. If you take a look at our borrowing over the last 12 months, it's $72,932 a second. $72,000 a second. And that's why the idiocy here of people who say, well, I'm going to save $1 million here. That's real money. Great. But let's see, if you're borrowing $72,000 a second, that's how many seconds did you just cover? You know, the $300 million that was stripped out one of the bills. Okay, fine. But it's 57 minutes of borrowing over an entire year. There's this just delusion. Every dime, I believe, of foreign aid is like now it's, I used to say 12 days of borrowing. Someone pointed out it's actually closer to 9 days of borrowing. Because we in the political class, math is hard. Our audiences often don't want to hear it because it doesn't satiate the feelings. We make public policy now by feelings, not a calculator. And so you have a world now where you get up and say, hey, it's demographics, we got old, it's healthcare costs are the primary driver of debt, and they look at you and go, no, it's waste and fraud and foreign aid. And you show the little chart that says, okay, I can get maybe a couple weeks of borrowing eliminated. What would you like to do with the rest of the year? And people just look at you in daggers. And then you have the left who just makes crap up. And I don't think it's meant to be evil. I think it's just that you get something in your head and you repeat it over and over and over and over. And the math is delusional. So I'm going to walk through some boards here. When we get to them, some of these are really complex. But I'm going to do my best so they make sense. Because how do you save this republic if you have a bunch of people who can't even agree on the most baseline of this was an OMB, CBO, joint tax, basically their data sets. It's no one reads their reports. The Joint Economic Committee, which, you know, I chair the Republican side, we did a brilliant report 2 months ago. We gave actually options where you could save this country. And it's crazy stuff. Like, did you know if you could actually eliminate, moderate, take on, do the moral thing with our brothers and sisters, and talk about diabetes and obesity? It's a few $1 trillion over 10 years. But it would require complex policies and decisions to do things that are difficult. So the whole reason I hold this board up, this board is from 3 weeks ago, and it's already out of date. What does this board say? It basically says next year interest will pretty much equal the defense budget. Interest will equal the defense budget. And the reason it's out of date is just the movement of interest rates in the last 3 weeks on the U.S. 10-year sovereign. Interest will be more than the entire defense budget next year. And if it continues, if the trend line continues, there's a very good chance that interest isn't going to be $830 billion. It could be starting to approach $1 trillion next year. And why is that a big deal? Well, let's do something else interesting. Okay. For people who have never really thought about it, how does the United States finance itself? Remember, 30 cents out of every dollar we spend is borrowed. Okay? Where does that 30 cents come from? We issue bonds. Every couple weeks, like 3 days ago, Treasury issued a $30-plus billion of five-year instruments. It went out at the very top of the range price-wise. So you sit there and have to calculate. Coverage was a little disturbing. It was only like 2.5 coverage. I know that doesn't mean anything to me. It basically means, the huge lines to buy U.S. bonds weren't there. The line is getting shorter and shorter, interest to buy our debt, which often means the interest rates are going to go up. Okay, but what happens to bonds that were sold in previous years? Because the last three Treasury secretaries, Republican and Democrats, did something stupid, and we couldn't get them to change it because it benefited them politically that week, is they went very short-term on the bonds. I'm going to issue 1 year, 2 years, 3 years. When interest rates were basically almost free, Guess where we're at right now? Those bonds are coming due. So in the next fiscal year, if we bring $2 trillion of new virgin issue, that's the borrowing for next fiscal year. Remember, this year we're going to borrow 2.3, 2.4, but let's just pretend next year is about 2. Well, we have a little problem. There's about $9.6 trillion of borrowing coming either as virgin issues or refinance next year, and it's all at these higher interest rates. Your government is functionally an insurance company with an army and a budget problem. What do we look like at the end of 2024 when we've just refinanced a little bit under $10 trillion at these higher interest rates? It basically means that dystopian number, as you go into the 2025 budget cycle of $1 trillion interest coverage, and interest buys you how many, if you're into the military stuff, buys you how many new weapons? If you're into your social justice agenda, interest buys you what? This is what we're doing to ourselves. And it's the reality. And the interest rates keep moving away from us. So let's continue on some of the more difficult stuff. Just a simple math. We're going to spend some time talking about how do you fix things when you can't even get the other side that you need. We have to do this together. It's complex. It's hard, and it's politically brutal because this place has functionally lied to the public for decades. So let's use the most optimistic, and I believe these numbers, one side of these numbers are absolutely wrong. It's basically saying, hey, next year, the projection months ago was, hey, the 2024 budget year was only going to borrow about $1.7 trillion. I think that's wrong. I think we're going to 2, but let's just say it's the 1.7. Let's say we did the most confiscatory tax ever. We basically took every American, you make $500,000, every dime you make above that, we take all of it. Every dime belongs to government. And people keep working. The basketball player, the scientist, the entrepreneur just keeps working. They don't basically say, well, I made my $500,000, government's going to take every dime, I'm just going to keep working and paying it all into government, which is a fantasy. That's not how economics work. But let's just, for a math experiment, let's say we're going to confiscate every dime of people over $500,000. You raise about $1.5 trillion. Okay. Did I mention the borrowing from CBO months ago was projected to be 1.7? You can't even cover the deficit if you had a fantasy number of taking every dime of those high-income earners. And yet, I will show slides like this at certain town halls where I have a number of Democrat activists, and they look at you going, well, that's Republican math. No, actually, I think this one came from Cato, but I have some that are from OMB, CBO, Progressive Budget Priorities. It's all the same. We're living in a mathematical fantasy world. So I'm gonna go out of sequence here because I'm angry that I saw a California member on CNN a little while ago basically holding a little whiteboard and completely lying to the press because it's such good politics. Republicans shouldn't talk about Social Security. You see, it doesn't add anything to deficit. Absolutely true. Because there's a trust fund that has cash in it for 9 more years. What happens in 9 years? Well, here's the reason we want to talk about it, to save it. In 9 years, the average couple on Social Security gets a $17,400 cut. You double poverty of seniors in America in 9 years. It's absolutely immoral. But the recapitalization of this is going to be complex because that first year, so 9 years from now, the first year shortfall is $616 billion. Okay, do this with me. For anyone, you don't have to be good at math in this. This isn't that hard. 9 years from now, boom, the trust fund's gone. You got $616 billion shortfall in 2033. Okay, big deal. You don't care. It's 9 years from now. But here's the Democrats' policy. We're just going to raise taxes on those who make $400,000 and up. So the Democrats' piece of legislation is $400,000 and up, you're going to pay the 12.4% FICA tax, all of it. Great, okay. Raise the taxes, every dime, you get no benefit from it. Let me slow down, let me explain. Today, you pay your FICA tax up to, what is it, $160,200, and then it stops. You don't pay the Social Security tax on above that because you don't get any benefit for it. So you create this donut hole under Democrat policy and saying, well, then you start paying the tax again when you hit 400,000, okay? That produces $86.3 billion in 2034. Well, let's use 2033, because that's the year the Social Security's on. So can anyone do the math with me? $86 billion of new taxes, $616 shortfall. Anyone notice a math problem? You're covering 1/7 of the shortfall. And that's the Democrats' solution. So let's actually do the more grand one. I'll get people say, well, David, we'll be just fine. Just eliminate that cap and make people pay the full, 12.4% Social Security tax on every dime for a person that makes $1 billion. They pay it on that. Okay. And they get no benefit. No benefit for those higher taxes. Okay. And people say, and that solves the problem. And then you show them this. Remember, the first year is $616 billion shortfall. Eliminating the Social Security cap produces $164,700. You're basically covering 20% of the shortfall. And this is the Democrats' grand solution. This is why, for those that own a calculator around here and have a soul of not wanting to double senior poverty, we're willing to get the crap kicked out of us by the activist left saying, but you're talking about Social Security, you're not allowed to do that. We're trying to save it. We're trying to save it because you have people manipulating you and lying to you about the math. This is immoral. In 9 years, you double senior poverty in America, and their solution only covers 1/7 or 20%. This is what you've been given. And then you wonder why there's friction. What if you have friction because some people want to tell great stories and some people would actually like to save the country? So let's walk through a few more of these. Mike, if you're bored, you're welcome to join me. Okay. All right. Either you can stand here with me. Mike Kelly, for everyone, congressman from Pennsylvania, he is my senior, so he sits to my left in Ways and Means, which annoys me because we need to explain a part of the inside joke. In Congress, there's only one committee that's solely by seniority, and it's called the Ways and Means Committee. And so when people to your left retire, quit, go away, you move up. Yep. If they're on this side, that makes no difference to your life. And you're senior to me, so I love you. But Mike Kelly also chairs the tax subcommittee. And Mike, this is one, I was trying to do something that was a little, because no one else has been willing to do this math. So our brothers and sisters on the left keep saying, we'll tax our way out of the crisis. So we did a simple, the first chart, I was trying to be somewhat brutal, saying, okay, tax revenues versus expected deficits under different wealth models. So basically, we bad some debt saying, okay, here's actually the deficit. This was the baseline deficit number. And here's what you got. So the Sanders wealth tax. Now understand, it's probably unconstitutional. This is where they would take and come in and say, we're confiscating, even though this isn't your income, we're confiscating some of your wealth. The big one they're pushing right now is the oligarchs tax, where they're going to come in and say, if you're really rich, we can come in and just every year take 8% of your wealth. The problem is
I got 1.8 trillion, and this thing is basically covering what? That's $230 billion of shortfall. It also blows up the economy, but it doesn't get you anywhere. And look, I'm not here to defend really, really rich people. I'm here to defend math. Amen. And look, you have a personality. I'm like a walking calculator. I mean, tell me, why am I failing to communicate the reality that the proposals we're getting are absurd? They only cover a fraction of the shortfalls.
Absolutely. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to walk down front, and I'm going to ask our folks to help us all the time. For those of you, and there's no reason for anybody to know me, my whole life has been in the private sector, and I've really come to believe that nobody should serve in the public sector unless they first have been in the private sector. My whole life has been about making sure that on the 6th of each month and the 21st of each month, there are special days for me, because those were days that the people who work with me every day got paid. So we use something called kitchen table economics. Now I sit beside David and I talk to him all the time. I said, I'm more of a person who says, you know what, let's use kitchen table economics. Now I'm told that Army manuals are written on at sixth grade level so that people can understand them. So I want to show you something. I reduced this down to a $1 bill. Because when you hear our friends talking about, oh, no, you can cut spending, you can do this. I want you to think of something, not as a member of Congress who can spend whatever he or she wants because it's not coming completely out of your pocket, but to the American people, hardworking American taxpayers. So we took a dollar bill, and we said, let's look at this dollar bill. Mandatory spending. This is money that has to be spent out of every dollar we collect from a taxpayer. Mandatory spending, 63 cents. Well, what do you mean by that? Well, we're talking about Social Security. We're talking about Medicare. We're talking about Medicaid. And, as all of you know, any loan you ever had, you're actually charged interest on it. 10 cents of every dollar. And this year, that represents $663 billion just to pay for the interest on our debt. That leaves us a whopping 27 cents out of every single dollar we collect from you. And this is the important thing. I am so fed up with elected officials talking about what they've done for you. They do nothing for you. Every single thing we do in this country is paid for by a taxpayer or a debt that you co-signed that you didn't know about. Now, I told you a little bit of my history. I'm an automobile dealer. Most people, 97% of the people that we sell a car or truck to, borrow money to pay for that car or truck. They sign their name to a contract. And we take great time to explain to them exactly what is expected of them. Now, so I told you this, 63 cents goes for Social Security, Medicare, and Medicaid, 10%, 10 cents on each dollar just to pay our debt down, $663 billion. That's why I wanted to reduce it down to kitchen table economics. This is what's happening to your dollar. Now we have 27 cents that we can spend any way we want. And what does that mean? Well, that includes transportation, education, defense, and other programs. So let's take a look at the 27 cents of our budget, of our revenues that we have left to spend. Of the 27 cents of each dollar, spending for defense, 13 cents. We don't ever want to walk away from that. In the world we live in now, are you kidding me? We're going to stop that. That leaves us, my friends, with 14 cents that we can actually control. Every single dollar out of your pocket is reduced down to this. And so when people say, you just have to learn how to cut spending, I say, so you gave me a dollar bill? I can,
Mike,
adjust 14 cents.
And, yes. And it's worth pointing out, for everyone looking at that, you see that chart of defense and let's call it non-defense.
Yes.
It's all borrowed. Every dime of that today is on borrowed money,
yes.
Plus another,
yes,
$400 billion of the mandatory.
Yeah.
And I think that's actually what so many of our brothers and sisters around the country don't understand. It's so out of whack now because the number one growth is healthcare costs, but that's sort of on autopilot because every time we try to fix it, the lobbyists, the Democrats lose their minds, and we're just trying to save the country. So we end up having the fights that are going on right now over that 14 cents. And look, there's waste, there's fraud, there's things in there we need to fix, but it's a fraction of the budget, and it's all on borrowed money, which adds the additional stress of there is a morality of squeezing everything we can out of it.
Well, David, and you and I, because we sit beside each other every day and we keep, I'm honestly, these are things that keep me up at night. In another month, my wife and I will be celebrating our 50th anniversary. I don't know what she was thinking of. All I did was ask. She said yes. And then for half a century, we've been going at this. But so we have 10 grandchildren, 10 grandchildren. And I'm constantly asked by people, how can you be so responsible when it comes to spending our tax dollar? I said, well, we don't want to be irresponsible. David and I sit there, and I got to tell you, sitting beside him is hard because he has so much going on in his head at one time. It's like a calculator, and I keep going back just to the basic. The 14 cents, David.
So in other words, you're telling people the truth, I drive you nuts.
Services, social services, natural resources, science, space, and technology, and other programs. We are down to the very 14 cents of a dollar. And this is a dollar that you paid, by the way. This is out of your taxes.
Well, they're paying the interest on it now.
Oh, well, the interest is $663 billion on what we owe.
And $800 billion next year.
Yes, and it keeps growing, and it keeps growing, and it keeps growing. No responsible person would ever sit back and work this model. The greatest country, the greatest nation the world's ever known, the wealthiest nation the world's ever known, has been totally irresponsible in the way she has spent her money. And it wasn't done by her. This incredible group of people that sit down here. And remember, I said this to begin with. I don't believe anybody should serve in public office until they've been in the private sector. I, myself, have been in situations on the 6th of the month and the 21st of the month where I made sure every person that worked at the dealership got paid. There were many times I did not pay myself because I didn't have enough money to do it. And the point I think we keep trying to make is that when are we going to wake up to what is going on? This is a titanic moment for our country. And the reason I say that is because the Titanic went full speed ahead into an iceberg. And what did the captain of the Titanic see? Just a small part. Just a small part of the iceberg was hidden up. They didn't see what was hidden. My friends, right now, the hidden part of what it is that we're spending, and I would just ask you to please think with us as we go through this. Reduce it down to where it makes sense and understand what is happening right now on the floor of this Congress. We represent you. We do not represent ourselves alone. We represent you. So, David, if we talk about this, and this is where we are, and I would just think that at some point we would sit back and we would say, I cannot watch this and allow this to happen to hardworking American taxpayers.
And I think in some ways you just described why the fussing over the budget documents is going on. Look, we put together a fairly some interesting slides here. We've never presented before. We took these from a researcher at Manhattan and a couple other places. And then we did the joint economic, some of my economists, we did some math here. We set this for 2033. So we actually had a year that's 10 budget years from now. We did not put in the fact that the Social Security Trust Fund is gone, and there's $616 billion that needs to somehow be recapitalized. That's actually not in this deficit number. We also rolled the number, so we baseline, for anyone that's really geeky out there, we ran this to the standard debt to GDP number, because there's a new update on what debt will be in 9 years from now that's now $3.1 trillion. If interest rates stay as high as they're spiking right now, it could be as high as 3.7, but we're going to use the $2.5 trillion. And the reason this board exists is we took, and I have a bunch of slides here we're going to walk through, but I need to set up the pitch first. If we took every tax that our Democrat colleagues talk about in the Ways and Means Committee and did what they call a revenue maximizing rate, there's a rate that you can charge that the economists and there are, and this is, you know, the economic modeling, where you maximize the tax collections before it rolls over and people change their behavior and the tax collections go down. So we actually added up, maximize estate taxes, maximize income taxes, maximize corporate taxes, maximize capital gains taxes. So we maximized everything. And then we also then came back and said, all right, here's the maximum number taxing the rich. This is the top 2%. If you make $400,000 or higher, you're part of the top 2% of income earners in America. You got to understand that. And then we also did, if you did the economic effect, what they call the dynamic score, which is always the real number we get. So here's our $2.5 trillion borrowing. If you did the full max on Democrats and got every dime, you get about $700 billion. And if you actually do the real number, where the dynamic score, it comes in about $450 billion. So you've just maximized all taxes. It gets you a fraction of the talking points. And my reason we're all going through these boards, how do I say this politely without sounding like a jerk? Our brothers and sisters on the other side, they may actually believe these numbers, but they're not real. And how do you make public policy that saves this country when half your brothers and sisters here say, no, we just tax people over 400,000, we'll be fine. And you show the slide and it's nowhere near that. They don't, the unwillingness to deal with the reality of the math. And this is one you and I have talked about a couple times, where if you basically look at our history, so go back to 1950, because actually what's fascinating is from 1950 till recently, you actually have history where sometimes we've had really, really high marginal tax rates, 90% for the top income earners. And then, you know, after tax reform, you'll lower, but you took away a bunch of the deduction. You took half of society and removed them from the tax rolls. They don't pay income taxes. But we actually built lots of charts that sort of show during times of high tax rates, you get pretty much the same part of the size of the economy and taxes. Low marginal tax rates, you get the same part of the economy and taxes. There's this concept of it always goes back to the mean. So the way you get more tax receipts to government is a growth in economy. That's the magic. That's how you get more tax receipts, is growth. But when we have really high marginal rates, the chart after chart after chart just shows you get the mean. When you've had very low, you get the mean, but it's a bigger pie because the economy starts growing again. And you show this to our Democrat brothers and sisters, and they'll often say, yeah, I've seen that, but my voters don't like that.
Because
it doesn't satiate the feeling of punishing.
So when we've talked about this, because we have time when we're in meetings to talk about this, but I want you all to try and just bear with me a little bit. And I know that at some point you say, I don't know if I like this dog and pony show. In my district, PA 16, the average income for a family of four, mom, dad, two children, is $54,000. Now, and this is because this is where it really starts to make sense. Federal revenues this year would be the highest we've ever got. They're projected to be $5 trillion. That's a lot of money. I mean, it's almost incomprehensible. Now, what we're projected to spend is $6.9 trillion. You say, well, that's only, that's not that far apart. It's only $1.9 trillion. Here's what it means. And please, I really, this is where it starts to sink in. That means a family that I represent in Western Pennsylvania earning about $50,000 a year is spending $69,000 a year. So you see what we're getting to? You see where it is? Because when you reduce the numbers down, first of all, the high numbers are just so high, it's unimaginable. It's also unimaginable that we can ever pay the debt down. But I will just say this to you. If we continue on the path we are going, if we disregard the basic math that stands there and the way we do it, and most of us, I can tell you, most of the time when I pay monthly bills, it is at our kitchen table, and I open my checkbook, and I start doing the addition, subtract, 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 subtract. And I just try to trying to understand how we can be so reckless. None of you would do this because you have too much respect for your children and grandchildren's future, and you also have too much respect for yourselves. Nobody would consciously do this. That's the problem. And that's the problem. One of my favorite movies, and I think this is what I just want to make a point.
You're
with
not going to do movie reviews.
But the movie that I really love is called A Few Good Men. So have you seen this movie?
Yes.
Jack Nicholson's in it, and he's being cross-examined in a trial, a military trial. And they keep asking him questions, and at the end, he becomes so frustrated. He says, "You can't handle the truth." In our lives, the people who raised us, our moms, our dads, our grandparents, would never have done to us what we are happening right now, and we're doing to our own grandchildren. We have to handle the truth. We have to face the truth. And David, this path that we're on, and this mission that we're on, and this idea that somehow we have to get the message out to our hardworking American taxpayers. Our future is being destroyed because of irresponsible spending. Now, just to be sure on this, your Social Security will never be touched. Medicare, Medicaid is not going to be touched. And the banks are never going to forgive us the interest on our loans, okay? That's the reality of it. So when you understand it that way, it becomes, oh my gosh, what are we going to do? And so, my friend, as we sit there and try to figure out what is it that we can do to save the future for our children, and I looked at pictures yesterday with your two children and say, oh my God, what are we doing to these kids? What are we doing to them?
Look, Mike, you and I have, in some ways, we are the yin and yang of districts. I have a very highly educated district, a fairly prosperous district. I'm Scottsdale, Phoenix. I'm blessed to have grown up there. And I have to accept, you know, the economic experience of a lot of my people are going to be very different than yours. But we're all in the same boat. And so back to trying to help people understand the reality. I do need to amend something you're saying, though. And we used to talk here that this debt is an existential risk to our grandkids. I'm sorry. It's a risk to your retirement. There's the reality of math. If you're retiring anytime in the near future, you got to understand we're heading towards the time where we're going to have to turn the printing presses on. Yeah. And when we turn those printing presses on, we wipe out your savings. We wipe out besides the misery we create for the devaluing of the dollar, devaluing of, you know, every bit of your savings, making it so your kids can never afford high interest rates out to the future. But it's not a crash. It's actually an extension of potentially decades of misery. And folks don't think this way. And look, I keep coming back to trying to make the tax collection argument. So why this is so important? Here's the 1950s, where we had a 90.5% tax on the top income earners. So, and a little deep secret, actually, the tax code today is more progressive than it was back then because they had the lower middle class pay income taxes back then. Today, they're off the tax rolls. But back then, we used to get 7.2% of the economy came in income taxes, even though we had a 90%. You go over all the years, there's been tax reform. So today, 2020, let's do that year. We functionally had a mean tax of 37%, not 90% as that high part of the marginal tax rate, okay? But we're getting 9.2% of the economy. Okay, most people have no idea what I'm talking about when I say, but here's the economy. Here's a really high marginal tax rate. We have a history of this, and repeatedly you're only getting about 7% of the economy in taxes. We lowered the marginal tax rate for these top brackets, and now we're getting over 9%. We get dramatically more because the economy got bigger. And you show this to our brothers and sisters on the left, and they'll often say, yeah, I know it, but it doesn't feel like I'm punishing people. And the amazing irony, do you know the highest income Americans vote for Democrats, not Republicans? It's the bizarreness. here you are in your district. You know, how many billionaires do you think you have in your district?
I don't think there's many. The people I represent, they're either in ag or they're in the fields.
Yeah.
They're in the mines, they're in the mills, they're on the rails. They are blue-collar people who are living an incredibly strong life because those families, and you all know this up there, the nuclear family, the mom and dad raising children, is the key to our success going forward. And in education based on the very foundations of what we know is true and is accurate and has been proven over the ages. The gift that America gave all its citizens was the gift of education. But it sometimes you look at it and say, and honestly, you and I can talk all day. I want you all to understand, and I wish the gallery was full. I really wish the gallery was full. This is a message. It's not a message of anger.
It's a
message of hope. We have got to change our spending. We just cannot sustain this irresponsible trajectory.
Look, there's a path where this works. And I want to double down on something. I want to make it perfectly clear. We're not defending rich people. We're not defending poor people. We're not defending the middle class. We're just trying to tell the truth. This is how it works.
Yeah.
That this is about a society that prospers. Prosperity is moral. And we first need to shut down the excuses for not actually doing anything, saying, oh, don't worry, we'll just take those 400,000 and take, fine. Okay, do it, fine. Democrats, do it. You had all sorts of chances to do it before this session. But they knew the math was a fraud. But it's great talking points because they can get on MSNBC or CNN and say, yeah, way off, just do this and we'll be fine. And it's not true. And there doesn't seem to be a reporter in this city who owns a calculator.
They won't touch it.
And look, this is one you and I have actually touched on. It was what happens when you have really high capital gains rates or really low capital gains rates. It turns out when you've raised capital gains rates really high, like is some of our Democrat proposals, you actually get less revenues. And we have charts of this going back to 54. When we started to play with some of those rates. So this is why, back to that concept, I'm going to show some numbers here when we get ready to close, that if everything was at revenue maximizing, whether it be capital gains, whether it be estate, whether it be income, even corporate, you take a look and you're only going to get about 1.5% of the economy of additional revenues, additional receipts. This year, we're borrowing 9% of the entire economy, just this year. And there's why the elegance of really good pro-growth tax policy, and then doing some of the things I've been on this floor dozens of times, you and I have talked about for a couple of years now. There's things you could do to crash the price of healthcare, the adoption of technology, the taking on something that's very uncomfortable, take on obesity, take on diabetes, take on the things that are both killing our brothers and sisters. Remember, the last 4 years, life expectancy in America has gone down. In a decade, next decade, we have more deaths than births in America. How do you help people understand? It's beyond just those of us who are math and budget geeks. The morality is what you talk about. That's why I was asking you to come share this time with me. I need someone like you who's able to talk to people's hearts, because sometimes I don't think I do it well. I sound like an accountant on steroids. The morality of opportunity, the morality of prosperity, the morality of our brothers and sisters, and I don't care if you're on one of my tribal communities, your rural communities, an urban community, take a look at the statistics of our brothers and sisters who are dying of diabetes and other diseases when we actually can have incredible impact of having them be healthy. How do you get this body to see sometimes great math is also great morality?
Yeah, yeah. So I would just pose this for those of you that have been watching this. Are we making sense? If we're making sense, could you just please raise your hand? I mean, does this make sense to you about what we're talking about or what we're doing with your dollars? No, it doesn't make sense. And we can't have the interaction. The only thing I can tell you
is... You're not allowed to actually see them react to you.
Yeah, okay.
But this is their house.
We just happen to represent them. This is your house. You know that. Everything that goes on in this house is being done by people who are voted in to represent you, not represent themselves, but represent you. And so that's why I ask, if it's not making sense, we need to know, because I've got to tell you, it makes no sense to me at all of what we're doing, not only to our future, but to our present. And if we can't grasp what's happening right now, and that's why I talk about the kitchen table economics, if I can reduce this down to a $1 bill, that I would hand you a $1 bill and say, oh, by the way, that first 73 cents, get back to me. Now, you can keep the 27 cents, but then I'm going to take another 13 cents out of it. So you really get down there, it's so small of what it is that we can control. And in your own lives, you know, if you have a mortgage payment come due, if you have a car payment come due, if you have health care costs come due, you can't walk away from that. And at some time or other, a lender's going to say to you, you know what, we'd love to help you, but we can't. The math doesn't work. It's not good for you. So, David, when we talked about this the other day, the real challenge is to make sure that we understand the path that we're on and not try to sugarcoat it for you. I know for myself, the hardest lessons in life to learn are not the days that you lost something. And I think all of us at one time or another, I wish I could go back and one day have time to sit across from my mother and father and thank them for what they did for us, my grandparents, and thank them for what they did for us, and say, I can't thank you enough for what you did for us. I'm just so disappointed that we haven't performed as well as you have had, and that made it possible for us to enjoy the most incredible country the world has ever known, a nation of people that is so diverse. There's no place else in the world. None of us are thinking about leaving to go someplace else, but it's our responsibility to make sure that it is a sustainable business model. And so if I'm not connecting with you, I apologize for that, but only because we have to understand the dilemma that we're in. This is not a scare tactic, by the way. This is a wake-up moment that we have to be aware of what is happening right now to each of us every day in every way.
Look, Mike, and I'm sorry you have to hear it all the time sitting next to me, but the math will win.
Yeah.
The math will always eventually win. Mr. Speaker Pro Tem, what's our remaining time? Excellent. Thank you, Mr. Speaker Pro Tem. Mike, I'm going to run through a couple boards real quick.
Please do.
It's going to be a little thick, and I'm going to do them quick, and we will put these up on the website. If anyone really wants to dive into this, I believe Brian Riedel, about 2 weeks ago, published a fairly substantive with amazing footnotes. So you can, if you actually care about the subject, get it, read it, pull out your calculator. You'll see it proofs out. So I'm going to blow through this real quick and then sort of help people understand why is some idiot on the floor of the House walking people through, you know, maximum sustainable revenue calculations, and I'm trying to make a point, there isn't an easy fix here. No. If we do a deficit commission or something of that nature, it turns out it's going to be complex. You are going to have to deal with things that don't seem interrelated, but they are. You're going to have to talk about immigration. You're going to have to talk about technology. You're going to have to talk about maybe AI. You're going to have to talk about a tax code that promotes growth. You're going to have to talk about changing the way we finance parts of healthcare. And you got to do it all at the same time. And you've seen this place. We're having trouble walking and chewing gum at the same time. So, all right, let's blow through this real quick. Part of the studies out there, and this is from CBO, OMB, and also the Tax Policy Center and the U.S. Treasury have all confirmed these numbers, that if you did a maximum sustainable revenue from taxing the rich, let's first do individual income taxes. You took the rich and said, you're the top 2% income earners. This is functionally anyone over $400,000. We're going to put a tax rate that maximizes receipts before the calculations say revenues would roll over. And, you know, for some of those, you know, that's like, you know, adding another 10 points on top of it. And then you actually tax some other parts of a state. You actually put a bunch of money into enforcement. So you do all the things. These are all the Democrat proposals added up, and you're picking up another couple points, another half a point of GDP or so. I have a board where I added all. Then we added in maximizing corporate taxes, Well, it looks like we can get up to about another 0.8% of GDP if you maximize taxes, because we have a little problem in the United States. You go up to like the 28% corporate tax rate, the next increment, you see a bleed saying, well, screw it, we're just going to recharter the headquarters in Ireland, those things. So you hit this point where you start to roll over, and this is in the liberal models, conservative models, the people that just do models, and you walk through everything from the corporate tax hikes that Biden's been promoting, even the new international tax that Secretary Yellen's been pushing. You do the additional, some additional corporate savings by IRS enforcement mechanism. Add that all up. What do you get from that? Then you go in and actually add in, we call it investment taxes. We're going to raise capital gains up to like 39.6%, which we know at that point you sort of hit a wall and you actually get less money in the taxes. You actually do other types. You close all the loopholes. You actually remove the ability to roll over certain assets, the 1031 exchanges, the like-for-like in kind. You take those all away. You basically take and say, we've done everything to start to maximize income taxes from the rich. Okay, that's a lot of money. But you actually take a look, and I'm sorry, but we had very little time. We took these directly from the report. You can get up to, if you do what they call static, no economic effects, that's about 2% of the economy in new taxes. Then when you do the actual, okay, people stop working, it changes investment, people basically hunker down. So the economic models, you actually get about 1.1 to 2%, so a mean of 1.5. Yeah. Okay, that's a lot of money. 1.5% of the economy in new taxes. Yay! But did I mention we're borrowing 9% of the economy just this year? So the utopian tax everything of that $400,000 and up. You've maximized every single tax. We're borrowing 9% of the economy just this year, and every tax proposal gets you another 1.5. Does anyone see a little problem? We're living in this fantasy world. And look, God knows I love my charts. and it's I sometimes feel guilty for all. But this one's actually really important for, particularly if you're one of my progressive left acquaintances and you care about income inequality and progressivity and all those things. Today's income tax code is the most progressive in U.S. history. That top percent of income earners now pay more of the federal income tax than any time in U.S. history. And this is after our tax reform that Mr. Kelly and I worked on. And they said, and yet, I promise you, today, tomorrow, someone will come to that microphone. Well, the Republicans give away to rich people, except we're taxing them more as a percentage of the tax collections, because we remove so many of our brothers and sisters, the 50% of folks in the economic term, lower quartiles, don't pay income taxes now. And there's the problem. It grew the economy right up to the time of the pandemic. Then we started spending money like crazy on corporate subsidies, Democrat proposals. It's fascinating. They accuse us of liking big business, yet they're the ones giving hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of billions of dollars out as subsidies to corporate America. And at the same time, our tax receipts are falling when they're doing it. It's the weirdest economy you've ever seen. It basically shows modern monetary policy, their Keynesian economics, have fallen flat in their face. Last board, even when you start to do the adjustments for, they call income inequality, you normalize those.
Just want to make sure.
We have a more progressive tax system today than we've ever had before. And when a member of Congress looks at you in the eyes and says, well, we're just going to tax people over $400,000, that solves the problem. I showed you the boards. It doesn't come close to solving the problem on saving Social Security in 9 years. It's only 1.5% of GDP when we're borrowing 9%. Is there anyone, Mike, I mean, you've been here longer than I have. Do we have anyone we work with that owns a calculator that's willing to save this country? I'll let you do the close.
Well, thank you for the chance to work with you and for all our friends in the gallery. This is called the People's House because it is truly your house. Anybody that's here was elected. They just didn't walk in and sit down. They take an oath of office to do things in your best interest. And so what we've been trying to go through, and then we look at all the different charts, all of you probably have a $1 bill somewhere in your wallet or your purse. I want you to imagine, take this $1 bill, and this is what you actually can control when it comes to the spending. And so when I hear this thing about, well, you just have to cut spending, you just have to cut spending, I said, that's fine. Could you please give me a roadmap of what you want us to cut? And that's not accepted because that's not what's being fed to you. So I've just got to tell you, listen, we're here because of you. We're here for you. I thought the dollar bill was the easiest way to show it because we're all used to that. As I told you, we have 10 grandchildren. Maybe you can all relate to this. When our kids were growing up, they liked to go skiing. And in the wintertime, because I'm from Pennsylvania, they came to me one time and said, Dad, can we go skiing? I said, no, I don't have the money to go this weekend. And they said, sure you do. And they went under the bed and they picked out my checkbook that has three checks to a page. And my son said, here, you have all kind of money. I said, well, you have to put the money in before you can write the check to take it out. That was a concept that a child didn't understand. And unfortunately, there's too many children representing you here right now that don't understand what is taking place in every American home and with every one of our hardworking American taxpayers. We're here for you. I don't care if you're Republican, Democrat, Libertarian, or just say, I just wish you keep people we say the heck out of our lives. We're here. We're representing you. I would ask you, please, communicate with the people who represent you to let them know that you're concerned about the way the country is going in the future, not only for our grandchildren and for our children, but also for us. So, with David, I just think that I hope we got through. And if we didn't, please contact us. We are here every day for you. For you. There's no other reason for us, Mike, to be here other than for you. So I want to thank you.
The gentleman from the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania, the gentleman from the great state of Arizona, your time has expired.